is for us to discuss a few issues that has happened in our schools. And we've also, as organization, have also conducted some research on the happenings on our campuses. And we want to share the outcome with you and then what we need to do in respect to the actions that we want to take and what we think that moving forward we should do as a nation and as people to protect our children. And for us, we all know that our education strategic plan is also focused on having a long life learning. And for that matter, it is not only about student learning in the classroom alone. It is also about protecting the right of children and making the environment conducive for learning. And for us to be able to achieve that, then we need to take the environment itself into consideration and making sure that the school environment is safe for the welfare of our children. As we speak, our safe schools policy is not really giving us the kind of results that we want to see. So we have recorded a number of cases that we want to share with you. And to start with, we as organization have received a petition from a family in Anomabo concerning the death of their final year of their son at Ghana National. And in the petition, they have expressed or given us invitation to seek justice for this particular child and the family. And as organization, we are not really looking at the family as the point of reference, but we are looking at a situation where we can make the environment conducive so that we don't record any cases of such when it comes to the welfare of children. And in doing that, we have referred the petition to our lawyers, a team of lawyers who are currently studying the petition. At the appropriate time, we would also announce to you the action that we're going to take in respect to that. And if you recall, in the Achimota case, we did the same thing, and then we referred the matter to lawyer Martin Pebu, who assisted on the pro bono services and were able to seek for justice for the family of Kelvin. And for me, the most important thing is that we should not wait to lose our children in our schools, especially to things that are preventable and things that we can take steps to deal with it. It should not be something that is caused by negligence. We feel that there are certain steps that we can take to address some of these issues. So we have received a numerous cases of death in our secondary schools, parents working to announce what has happened to their children and how the system treated them, you know, and how they tend to neglect the medical concerns of these children. We have received a lot of such cases. And some we have not validated it yet. So as part of this engagement, we do not include that in the figures that I'm about to present to you. I'm sure when you receive the press statement, you will see the statistics that we have. But to also just give you a brief of what is happening, from February 2024 up to July 2024, we have recorded 4 deaths in our secondary schools due to medical negligence. And for me, it's alarming. And over the years, within the period of 2021 up to date, the ones that have been reported, we've recorded about 11 cases of children who died as a result of negligence in our secondary school, especially in the boarding schools that we have. And as I've said, I'm just giving you the statistics on the reported cases. The number of cases that we have received as organization, and we've not validated it yet, so we did not include it in our press statement. So at the appropriate time, I'm sure we would, once we are done with the validation, we'll be able to give you update on that. But what is happening in terms of the state of our children in our boarding schools is a bit alarming, because per our calculation, the average school that we have in this country is taking care of over 1,000 children. For that matter, the issue of having a comprehensive system to deal with issues of welfare and well-being is a matter of priority that we need to take into consideration and begin to provide a comprehensive approach to things and how we can integrate the services that are available. Because to us, the school has gradually become a community on its own where all services must be available to our children. They are self-contained communities, and the services must be available for them. So what we expect, that what happens within a normal community system, we expect that some of these services would also be available to our children in secondary schools, which of course means that they will need a medical facility, they will need the services of a social welfare officer, they will need the services of people who must have a say in their development. And to some extent, I would say that they would even need a clinical psychologist in our boarding facility to be able to take care of their needs that they go through. And this also brings back to the issue of whether or not the population that we have in these schools, you know, the teacher, the student to teacher ratio when it comes to welfare is something that we can boast of. Because if you have over 1,000 children in the school and you have few teachers who are taking care of their welfare, then it also raises a concern as to whether the system itself is willing and ready to deal with the issues of welfare in our schools. And for me, the issue of seeking for the welfare of children is not just issue that we are just discussing in terms of the social context, but it has become legal. Because if you look at the Kelvin case, the judge was so clear that once a child finds him or herself in a school environment, it is the responsibility of the school to provide care for the child. It's no longer in the hands of the parent to provide care. So the court has also established the foundation for which we need to also engage our educational facilities to know that moving forward, when children are in school, the duty of care has been transferred to the school. So for that matter, everything must be put in place to ensure that they enjoy those duty of care, so that the school system should not look at it as if, when it comes to certain conditions of children, the parent, though they are in school, the parents still owe those children the duty of care. So that has been established clearly, that when it comes to those things, it is the school that must provide that duty of care. And based on this, that's why we are saying that now schools have become a self-contained communities, and they also need certain facilities. Then again, we've also realized that within the school system, the number of issues that are happening that we should take into consideration. The first has to do with unclear nature of our exit system. There is no clear policy and guidelines regarding the operationalization of the exit system. So the issuance of those has just been at the discretion of the system as to determine what issue that they want to issue the exit on, and on what and what they can refuse, you know. And it has become a discretionary power that they do exercise in the lives of our children. And we think that that should not happen, It's a regime to regulate the conduct of children. It's a regime to maintain a certain level of discipline. So we expect that those things would also be taken into consideration when they issue the exit, especially where the school knows that they owe children the duty of care. So you do not use your own discretion to determine how to issue exit, but we feel that the issuance of exit to have a regulation and there's the circumstances under which those things must be issued must cut across. And based on this, when you see some exit that we have reviewed, you clearly see that it is not even consistent with the regulations of Ghana Education Service, which means that the schools are issuing exit based on how they feel. So there's no clear-cut policy as to how they should do it. So everybody is doing their own thing, and we feel that that would also not help. So depending on how the one in charge of the exit feels, that is when the person will decide that they want to issue the exit. And we feel that that will not really help. So there is a need for us to look at the exit system and then put certain things in place to ensure that, you know, children do not abuse the exit system, and then also the school authorities also do not abuse those exit systems. So it is important that we look at it and have a very consistent policy that will cut across all schools so that people will not use their discretion to determine what when to issue it and how to issue the exit. Again, there are a lot of issues regarding the regimes that we have in our secondary school where people feel that they would rather protect the integrity of the school rather than to promote the welfare of children. Because at the end of the day, the Constitution has dedicated our school system as a means by which children can acquire knowledge and also become somebody in the future. So it's not an environment that is just created by the management of the schools, but it's the environment created for our children. So we feel that the management of the school should always look at the best interest of children rather than to look at the reputation and the dignity of schools. Because there are a lot of children who are going through a lot and the schools are not willing to disclose any information regarding issues that affect children. So they tend to put up a defense as to how they are living up to their responsibilities and all. And for instance, in our research, when we got to Bishop Porter Girls, where we recorded a death case, the house mistress, very proactive, and just to buttress the point that in terms of the discretionary powers, this woman can even go to the hospital and be with the children until they find a situation where either they want to transfer the child to the parent or they think that the school can handle it. But if you go to other schools, it is not like that. Sometimes you may not even find the housemaster or the house mistress to be able to provide the kind of services that need to be provided. So for us, as organization, we require, the system need a policy reform, you know, in our secondary schools to integrate the issues of welfare for our children. The social safety net in our schools should be very strong, and we have to build it in a manner that will look at issues of welfare and well-being of our children. And it is important for the schools to also make it as part of their reporting to also report on human rights values or human rights issues in our schools, so that at least we know what is happening to our children, how they are handling children, and what our educational system is doing in protecting the human rights values or the human rights of our children in secondary schools. Then again, we are also saying that the school system itself should be designed in the way that it should be a child-centered organization or institution, because sometimes it is as if children are are accessing the environment at the mercy of the authorities. But in fact, the environment is designed for the children, and the authorities are employed to work for children. So that kind of orientation must be there, so that when they are providing services for our children, they will know how to go about it. And the third one, the fourth one that I want to talk about has to do with how Ghana Education Service would have a policy that will match a student-to-teacher ratio, the matching policy. We call it a matching policy of a student-to-teacher ratio. And this is important because you cannot have an institution hosting over 1,000 children and you do not have a policy in place that would also look at the welfare and matching those who are supposed to do that against the students. So for instance, if you have a 50 student, you expect that probably 50 children will be taken care of by one person or two persons, but we don't have that. So you go to our boarding facilities, you see only a house mistress or a house master with assistants managing over 200 and 400 students. And that makes it very, very difficult for them to be able to monitor what is happening. Then we are also saying that across board, and no school is a model, because most of our infirmaries are not working in our secondary schools. And for me, it raised a whole lot of issue. Then again, we also realized that sometimes when students go there to access medical care, they don't meet anybody there. They meet their own colleagues who are manning the place. And their own colleagues, they are not professionals to be able to know what is happening. So sometimes they dispense certain drugs to their own colleagues to take without any medical direction. And for me, that is dangerous. And our system should be able to look at that and bring it to a level where it can protect the interest of our children. And to end, we want to say that, yes, the call that we have received from the family, we will definitely take the steps that is needed to protect the welfare of our children and to make sure that such things do not happen in our secondary schools. And when we do so, we would also inform you about the next step ahead of us. So I want to once again say thank you for coming, and we appreciate your participation and engagement. So if there is any questions or
please subscribe to Morris TVGA.